Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Our Savior's Lutheran Church, both here and online. We have a handful of announcements today. Krista, I heard you wanted to do a Good Earth Village announcement. Is that right? Okay, we'll start with Krista.
All right, I have a handful of things here. We've got this coming Friday, the 23rd, the Murphys, which I believe, oh, there he is, right there in the back there, waving his hand. So the Murphys have graciously invited the entire congregation out to their farm for Friday night at 6 p.m., and they will be making some sloppy joes, hosting games, music, and just good fellowship. So we ask that you just bring a salad or a favorite dessert to share with everyone, and remember your lawn chair. There is some seating, but it may be limited. So again, that's this Friday at 6 p.m. out at the Murphys. We do have a little slip with the address and information. If you haven't already received that from the ushers, please see them at the back of the church. We've got some for you to take home.
Scott, was there other stuff you want? Here, I'll run over. Not everyone can.
I've got quite a voice here.
Yeah.
So if you're familiar with Old Plymouth Avenue, we are about 3.5 miles west of Ashley Furniture. And then I just wanted to get a show of hands about how many people are planning on coming. Okay, perfect. So we welcome all of you, and thank you.
Awesome. And Lisa is handing out sheets. Lovely.
Indeed, take those flyers. All right. Then we've got, many of you may have already seen some of the advertisements, maybe you've grabbed a brochure, but we have the fall retreat coming up just right around the corner on September 20th through the 22nd. That is out at Good Earth Village. And this is a wonderful tradition of fall revival, essentially. And so this year, we will be watching the movie Inside Out. Many of you may have heard of it. There is a second movie coming out recently. So again, we'll be watching Inside Out Friday night all together. And then Saturday, we'll be reflecting on that movie and looking at how it correlates with our own emotions and walk in faith. There will be, again, games, activities, art projects, time for reflection, and plenty of free time to enjoy the wonderful grounds out at Good Earth Village. So please go ahead and grab a brochure out at the welcome desk, sign up. We do have a deadline of August 26th, simply so we can get a good handle on how many people will be attending. So the sooner you can sign up, the better for that.
Awesome, thanks. The only other things I have is that our backpack blessing is next week on the 25th. So if you are interested in participating in that, it is for all people who might be going to school, teachers, all of that stuff. So if you're you are all welcome. There you go. To join us for that. Otherwise, there is a bulletin board back over there, which is talking about our education signups. So that is registration for Sunday school, registration for confirmation, as well as registering to volunteer to teach Sunday school. We always love new faces. I promise you, it is so easy to do, and it's really, really rewarding. So if you're interested in that, please go there as well. I think that's, should it be closer? A little louder, got it. All right, Norma would like to say an announcement. I'll just run over to you. Huh? I didn't see one. Oh my gosh, that's my problem. Thank you, Leah.
As of your notice from last week, there is now an action in place or begun to establish volunteers for here at Our Savior's. We have a lot of jobs around, and they're not, right now, being done very well. And so we need to step in and begin to do those. You all here should be giving thanks for a particular couple who have seen that you had coffee over the last several months. There haven't been people signing up, and so they have taken it upon themselves to check every Sunday morning as they come to church and be sure that there's coffee and things for you. So I think we need, there are lots and lots of things, and the beginning step of this is determining what jobs, what tasks, what opportunities are there for us to volunteer for. People don't just volunteer an hour a week. That doesn't work. We have all busy schedules. We want to sign up for things we know we like to do, we want to do, we maybe learn to do. But we have to have the jobs first. So that's where we're at this point, is collecting all the different kinds of things that you see that we as a church can, perhaps should, be doing. So out at the welcome desk right now, there are little half sheets of paper that you can pick up, think about a bit as you walk around here. I know we have at least 8 bathrooms, I think there might be 10, that have to be tended to. We don't usually use all of those, but who knows who happens to walk down a hall and use a bathroom and it needs to be checked afterwards. So we've got a lot of things that we need to do besides making coffee, having ushers, having people to help with communion. So that there are lots of things out there for us to do. We're even very much in need of people to help with the video and with the sound system. So we've got all kinds of technical levels of things for people to do. But we need to know what those jobs are. And then we can come out and say, okay, what would you be willing to volunteer for? On the sheet it says that the August 31st is the deadline. That's mainly because I want to get started on making that, having that list done so we can bring it out to you and have people begin to sign up. But anytime you see anything that you think would be a good thing to be done and could be done by a volunteer, it may not save us a lot of money. It might save us some, but it will make this place that much more enjoyable, useful. Also think about the things that we can do out into the community. What are different opportunities that we have to help out there? There are lots of them. And what ways could we approach those in a community type way instead of, well, I volunteer to do this or one individual volunteers to do that? We need to be thinking about all of those things because we're here as Christ's ministry community, and it's time for us to get on the road and get doing it. Thank you.
Thank you, Norma. I think that concludes all of the announcements that we have today. So let us begin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, in the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. We'll continue with hymn 542. Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Ever-loving God, your Son gives himself as living bread for the life of the world. Fill us with such a knowledge of his presence that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life to serve you continually through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Today's reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 20. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Word of God, word of life.
Please rise if you're able for the gospel. The gospel according to John chapter 6. Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of Christ. And now we'll have Jessie with the children's sermon.
If anyone wants to come up and join me, they're more than welcome to. Oh my goodness, what a summer outfit. So colorful. We're all wearing dresses today. Look at that. Ah, twinning, love it. So, in our lesson today that Rod so kindly just read for us, Jesus talks a lot about giving us his life. And so Jesus actually gives us eternal life, which is something that Jesus did not have to do, but so kindly gave us. And so because Jesus is so, so kind to us, we are then able to take that kindness and share it with everybody else. And so I thought it'd be really appropriate if I could share a story about kindness with you guys today. Sound good? Yeah? All right. So this book is called The Suspicious Stranger, and it's by Catherine Wheeler and illustrated by Julie Anderson. Psst, did you hear about that new squirrel, Sally? Called out Freddy Squirrel from his tree. He's very strange. Strange? Sally stopped sweeping her front doorstep to listen. Freddy shrugged. He's not like us. Sally's Aunt Bertha called from her tree. He has huge, dark, and beady eyes. Sam Squirrel, who was down on the grass burying a nut, nodded and called out, He's small. He's sneaky. I hadn't seen him once since he moved into that hickory tree. Sally sighed and put her broom away. Her neighbors were always so nervous about newcomers. I'll try to make this squirrel welcome, she decided. I'll take him some rose leaf tea. After Sally polished her walnut collection and made her bed, she put some tea in an acorn canister and took it over to the hickory tree. She knocked at the knot hole at the door. Anyone home? She called. There was a rustling and a bustling, and then a door burst open. Sally blinked in surprise. The squirrel, dressed in very flashy pajamas, had obviously been asleep in the middle of the day. Sally stammered, I'm your new neighbor, Sally. I brought you some tea. The small gray squirrel just stared. Finally, he took the acorn canister. Thanks, he murmured drowsily as he closed the door. Sally was appalled, asleep during the day. Why wasn't he busy looking for nuts and looking for berries? And now that she thought about it, the little squirrel wasn't at all polite. He practically shut the door in her face. That evening, just after Sally had pulled up her feather quilt and settled into her pine straw bed, there was a knock at the door. It was the strange little squirrel. "Oh, I'm sorry if I woke you," he said. "I wanted to thank you again for the tea. I was very sleepy before, and I didn't introduce myself. My name is Squeak." Sally grabbed the little squirrel and pulled him indoors. "What are you doing out at night?" she cried. Don't you know how dangerous it is?" Squeak blurted, "But I always look for food at night." "There are owls and other scary animals out there," said Sally. "An owl would have a hard time catching me," Squeak replied. After Squeak had left, Sally went back to bed, puzzled about the strange squirrel. She wasn't quite sure what to make of him. Could he be an orphan, she wondered. Maybe he didn't have a mother to teach him properly. Then Sally had a brilliant idea. "I know. I'll leave him a note and ask if he'd like to food hunt with me. Then I'll give him some lessons." So she left a note at his door to see what he would say. The next morning, Sally found a birch bark note under her door. "No need to worry about me," Squeak had written. "I'm fine. Perhaps I could take you out one night and hunt with me by the light of the moon." Sally sighed again. "Well, I've done my best to help," she thought, and went out to look for food. That day, Sally had good luck. She stumbled into a new patch of blackberries. She went all day hiding the berries one by one. Sally worked so hard she didn't notice the sun was going down, and she definitely didn't hear the sound of shifting feet in the bushes behind her. "Blackberries all winter," she hummed happily. When Sally picked up the last gleaming berry, she sat down and ate it for her supper. Suddenly, the air was filled with a strange whoosh. Sally gasped. It was Squeak. He had jumped off a high branch, but instead of falling, he sailed right through the air. Squeak could fly. "Didn't you hear me calling? There's a fox. Hurry," Squeak said as he yanked Sally onto the trunk of the tree. They scrambled up the bark just as a fox jumped out from the bushes, jaws snapping. Sally struggled onto a high branch and gasped. "Thank you, Squeak. You saved my life. How did you do it? Why didn't you fall when you jumped? You're a squirrel, aren't you?" Squeak laughed. "I sure am, but I'm a flying squirrel." He stretched out one of his front and back legs and showed her the flap of skin between them. "Just works like a wing," he said. "Wow, isn't that why you aren't afraid of owls?" Squeak nodded. "But I am afraid of foxes," he said, looking down at the red triangle of a face of fear below them. "How can I ever repay you?" said Sally. "No need," said Squeak. "I'm repaying you for your kindness, and you're the only one who has ever made friends with me." "The others will too," Sally promised. "I'll tell them how you saved me." She handed Squeak half the berry she still had with her. "Do you care for some supper?" Squeak smiled and thanks. "I don't get many blackberries. They're so hard to see in the dark." After they ate, the new friends chattered at the fox and threw their leaves down at his face until he gave up and slunk away. Sally raced home as the stars came out and the moon rose. As Sally scurried, Squeak flew from the branch to branch, guiding his friend safely to her front door. The end. So flying squirrels are actually real things, which is kind of fun. But I thought this was really fun that we get to talk about squirrels, obviously, right? Squirrels don't talk, they're not real. But we get to talk about how we can repay kindness with our neighbors. So I challenge you this week, find something really nice that you can do for someone you love or somebody near you. And then we can see how good that feels, right? How nice it is to be able to repay people with kindness. All right, let's join in prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for helping us to be kind to all of our neighbors, just like we learned in this book today. Thank you for giving us your life so that we could live forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thanks, Jessie. So the gospel text for this Sunday is part of the same sermon that Jesus preached the day of the feeding of the 5,000. So I'd like to go back to that just for a little bit. The disciples had almost no food, and they wanted to send the whole crowd away to fend for themselves. Well, Jesus was not having any of that. Jesus told the disciples to feed them. They scrounged what they could, finding 5 loaves and 2 fish, and they brought them to Jesus. Do you think that the crowd understood what Jesus was going to do? Do you think that the disciples understood what was going to happen next? I think what they did understand was that they had seen Jesus do miraculous things. They understood that he was no ordinary man. They understood that if anyone could feed so many with so little, it was Jesus. But they could not yet believe it until they saw it. The disciples had faith in Jesus even when they could not believe, when they didn't understand. Just because they couldn't understand didn't mean that they weren't fed. Just because they could not understand did not mean that Jesus would send them away hungry. A few weeks ago, Pastor Sherry dismantled the idea that Jesus told the disciples to feed the multitude to test them. That the word translated as test was better translated as try a new understanding of God. The disciples trusted Jesus even when they could not understand. This week's gospel is similar. It seems to stretch the boundaries of what is possible. The Jews were arguing how Jesus could give his flesh to eat. It seems they could not see the spiritual meaning behind it. Was Jesus speaking of eating his actual flesh? Or was he speaking metaphorically about what was to become Holy Communion for all of us? I do know that the Jews were having a hard time believing or trusting. They were having a hard time trying a new understanding of how God might work among them. A few years ago, when my father-in-law, Ned, was deep in the midst of Alzheimer's disease, his pastor in Sheboygan, Wisconsin, decided that it would no longer be appropriate for Ned to receive communion because she doubted he could understand it any longer. She doubted Ned's understanding. When my wife Heidi told our pastor in Dubuque, Iowa, the reason that her dad could no longer receive communion, he replied, "Then I'll go give him communion." He went on, "Do any of us really understand what happens in communion? I've been a pastor for nearly 40 years, and I don't understand it." That made me feel good because it's always been kind of a mystery to me. Well, we did not ask our pastor to make the 3-plus-hour trip to give communion to Ned. But it was wonderful that he made that offer. Instead, another pastor from Sheboygan gave Ned communion. And during the rite of communion, Ned recited the Lord's Prayer by heart, just as he has done for, at that time, close to 90 years. He still trusted Jesus to feed him. Just because Ned could not understand didn't mean that he wasn't fed. Just because Ned could not understand didn't mean that Jesus would send him away hungry. Heidi and I spent last week on vacation in the north woods of Wisconsin, surrounded by tall trees and clear water in lakes, with our alarm clock, the call of loons. We took a week to rest and just breathe. While there, we did one of our favorite activities, kayaking. As we glided through the water almost effortlessly, I remembered those first few times on the water when I was first introduced to kayaking. Now, I always strive to do things well. I'm not always successful. In fact, I am usually driven to do things better than other people. Blame it on my competitive spirit, but when I applied this spirit to kayaking, it didn't work very well. First, I found it was very unsteady in the kayak. I tightened my core muscles in an attempt to stay steady on the water, but it made it worse. It wasn't until I relaxed that I found that I could roll with the kayak and maintain control. I had to trust the boat. Second, when paddling, I would drive my paddle deep in the water and pull it back with great effort. As I did this, I found that I didn't just go forward, but I also turned. With every stroke I went forward, I turned. Left and right. I spent that first day zigzagging across the river. First to the right bank, then to the left. I was frustrated. Then the next time we kayaked, it was exactly the same until our friend, an experienced kayaker, suggested that maybe if I didn't drive the paddle quite so deep, but more to the side of the kayak, it might work a little better. This helped minimize the turning effect. As I felt this, I also relaxed, and I tried not to paddle quite so hard, and I began to trust this paddling technique. Last year, we bought kayaks that had an interesting feature that was new to both of us, the skeg. A skeg is a spring-loaded rudder hidden in the body of a kayak that you can lower and raise as you wish. When it's down, the skeg keeps the kayak tracking very, very straight. When it's up, you can turn much easier. So my point about all of this talk about kayaking is that I had to try a new understanding with kayaking. Though I could not understand why I could not force myself to be steady in a kayak, I needed to trust the boat. Though I could not understand why I kept zigzagging from bank to bank, I needed to trust paddling a little differently. Though I could not understand exactly how a skeg works, I needed to trust that it will offer added control. These are all real-world illustrations that can help us realize that we don't have to understand everything about how God, the Father, Christ the Son, or God, the Holy Spirit, work. All we need to do is trust. We trust in God when we pray. We trust in God when we step out to help someone. We trust in God when we care for others. We trust in God when we eat the wine and the bread of communion. And just because we might not understand doesn't mean that we won't be fed. Just because we might not understand doesn't mean that Jesus would send us away hungry. And now, May the peace which surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.